Welcome back to When Harry Met Board Games, where we feed our people with relatable content, and our victory condition is your satisfaction. I'm Harry, and today we have another board game comparison. Today I'm going to be comparing these two games here, Agricola and Caverna, the Cave Farmers. Now, both of these games here are designed by Uwe Rosenberg, and clearly Caverna was like a spiritual successor to Agricola. Now, the argument in the hobby nowadays is which of these two games is superior, and it's a very divided argument. Lots of people actually usually prefer one totally to the exclusion of the other. I, for one, am a fan of both of them, but over the course of this video, you will have an idea of which of the two I prefer. So first of all, we're going to start with components. So first of all, we start with the box cover here. This is a more modern edition of Agricola. Just a few years ago, it came out. And then here we have Caverna and its box art. So the box art is from the same artist. This was originally published by Lookout Games. So we're going to see lots of similarities as far as art and graphic design is concerned. Now let's see the pieces. Again, since we're talking about the same original publisher, you're going to see lots of similarities as far as the pieces are concerned. So we have lots of these wooden pieces in this game. Let me just take out this insert I have here for Agricola. And we have lots of these wooden pieces here. I would say that the difference between Caverna and Agricola is that the Animeeples and the veggie meeples are a little bit chunkier and bigger in Caverna. For example, here you can see the cattle. On the left, we have the cattle for the Agricola game, and on the right, we have the cattle of the Caverna game. And you might not be able to tell on camera, but the camel for Caverna is a little bit thicker and a little bit bigger than the Agricola one. Then we have, the grain here. And I think it's a little bit more obvious that the grain for Caverna, which is here on the right, is a little bit chunkier, wider, and bigger than the grain in Agricola. So for starters, we have very nice wooden chunky pieces for both games. But yes, the chunky pieces in Agricola, or in Caverna, I should say, are a little bit chunkier, thicker, and bigger than the ones in Agricola. Both games have lots of tiles that players are going to use to place on their player board. And again, the tiles from a production perspective look pretty similar. Now, when it comes to the worker pieces that the games use to represent their workers, the Caverna game comes with these circular discs that represent your dwarves, your family, your workers that you're going to be placing on the board. Now, the original Agricola also came with circular discs for your workers and your farmers, like Caverna as well. But the more modern editions come with these nice farmer-shaped meeples that have more of a real look to them. They look like people or persons. You could also buy these custom-made miniatures for the Agricola game that really add an additional level of realism and thematic flavor to it. But I must say, in the defense of Caverna, it has a very practical purpose, a very practical appeal, because one of the things you do in Caverna throughout the game is that you level up your character. This is kind of like a fantasy-themed version of Agricola. Your dwarves level up so they could go questing and adventuring. And when they level up, you're placing these discs on them, these circular discs that tell you... these little tiles here that tell you what level that character has made it to. So you simply just put it on top of them to let you know going forward that that particular worker is leveled up. He's at level 13. So when he goes questing, he's going to get more loot or more rewards than a weaker or a lower leveled dwarf in your family would get. So again, for a practical perspective, retaining this circular disc makes sense, because if you had a meeple, it would be a little bit harder to indicate that that meeple has been leveled up. Another big difference in this game is the improvements that players can acquire throughout the game to make their living areas, their living quarters, more practical for living, to make their actions more efficient. In Agricola, you are using these different cards. You have occupation cards, which represent different workers that you can hire that will give you benefits throughout the course of the game. You got your amateur fencer and your young artist and your field counter and your top outer and your stone custodian, right? You also have these minor improvement cards, like the bagpipe and the junk room and the milk jug, the carpenter's parlor, the hand plow, the acorns basket. And these minor improvements, just like the occupation cards, are going to be ways to enhance your actions going forward. You're going to have to carry out actions in order to activate these abilities, but going forward, they're going to help you in diverse ways. In Caverna, the upgrading is going to come through the use of tiles, not cards. And these tiles represent dwellings and different furnishings that you're going to use and place in your cave, in your cavern. The game, the name of the game says it, Caverna. Basically, players, instead of having a house like they do in Agricola, in Caverna, you have a section of the board, which is your cave. And your cave starts out with two rooms. And as the game progresses, you're basically excavating your cave in order to create new quarters, new spaces for you to place dwellings and different furnishings that are going to help your characters execute certain actions, produce certain resources, accommodate additional family members, and ultimately give you victory points at the end of the game. So here I'm going to show off the differences in the different player boards. This is what your player board looks like in Agricola. You have your starting house with two rooms. And as the game progresses, you're going to add additional rooms to your house. You're going to add or plow fields so you can plant crops and reap them. You're going to create pastures by building fenced stables in order to put your animals and your different creatures for your animal husbandry and contain them there and hopefully breed and grow more of them. So this is your Agricola board. Your Caverna board is divided into two sections. You have your field section here, which starts off with a bunch of trees that you're going to have to fell, that you're going to have to cut down in order to make room to plant your crops, to plow your fields, to create pastures for your animals. But here on the right side, you have your cavern, which again starts with one dwelling for two dwarves. And as the game progresses, you're going to be excavating the land in order to create more opportunities to put additional dwellings and additional furnishings in your cavern to upgrade it and to optimize your actions going forward. You're also going to create mines so that you can mine for certain resources like stone. You're going to mine for rubies, which are a very valuable resource in this game. Caverna is also very generous, as we see a couple spots on the board that the moment you build over them, they give you a reward of either a few food or maybe a pig into your possession. So that's a reoccurring theme that you're going to find in Caverna. It is by far the more generous game of the two, and you're going to see lots of different ways in which they execute it. You also have your knight side. These are reversible. You have your knight side of the Caverna board, just in case you want to pretend that you're playing at nighttime. A big difference in this game is that Agricola has 14 rounds, and round by round, you are revealing a card that adds an additional action to your worker placement options. You start off with a few standard options depending on the player count, and each round we add and throw in an additional action. Caverna follows that model in the sense that you have your standard starting spaces depending on the player count, but then afterward, you also have your additional actions that are added round by round, but in Caverna, we only have 12 rounds. Now, I mentioned earlier that Caverna was the more generous game of the two, and one of the ways that it implements this is through the use of the harvest round. In Agricola, every so often, we have a harvest round in which we must feed our family members, we must reap our harvest from all of our different fields, and we must breed our animals if we have room, space, or capacity for them. In Caverna, the game starts off with very few harvest rounds, but once we get to a certain point, every round becomes a harvest round, which sounds a little bit stressful and intense. However, what's interesting is we're going to have these face-down tokens placed on each of these different harvest rounds, going from round 6 to round 12. And each of these harvest rounds, when we flip over that token, it's going to tell us something about that harvest round. Perhaps it's not a harvest at all, right? Which would be a break from all the stress of having to produce for those harvest rounds. Sometimes in those harvest rounds, you might not have to necessarily feed your people, or you might only have to pay one food per family member instead of two food per family member. Some of these harvest rounds can actually be a little bit detrimental because instead of doing both the reaping your crops and the breeding your animals options, you might have to pick one or the other instead of both. So, and then again, you also have your regular, typical, standard harvest rounds where everything that you know about the harvest rounds in Agricola will apply. You're going to feed your people, you're going to breed, and you're going to reap. So again, this adds a little element of mystery as you flip over those tokens and discover at the beginning of a round what's actually going to take place or what are the harvest rules for that round. But again, this comes by the end of the game. In the first five rounds, we only have one harvest. So you have five rounds to build up your engine and do so. And even the stress of these frequent harvest rounds is not really too big of a deal, because in Caverna, there's so much additional ways of producing food to feed your family. First of all, as this little key here on the bottom indicates, you do not need any upgrade, you do not need any furnishing, you do not need a minor or major improvement as you do in Agricola in order to convert animals into food. The animals at any point and any time can be immediately converted into food. And the key here tells you which of those animals is worth how much amount of food. Caverna also comes with these gem resources, which you can acquire from time to time. And these gem resources are kind of like a wild card of sorts, because you can use them and interchange them with different things. You can choose to spend a certain amount of them to get a pig, or to get a cow, or to get a donkey. This is an additional animal in this game that you could breed, is your donkeys. And the gems have lots of other uses throughout the game as well. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Caverna is a fantasy version of Agricola, where your family members are actually dwarves. And one of the ways that they integrate this is through the use of questing or adventuring. So you have some of these worker placement spots that feature an option for theme. For example, we have this logging spot right here. And if you place your worker here, not only will you be able to snatch up all the wood that's accumulated there thus far, but after that, you would be able to go on a level one quest, which means you will take your character who has a weapon, your character must have a weapon, and based on their level of weapon, they will be able to get one reward that is equal to or lower than their weapon value. So, for example, if your dwarf has a weapon value of 7, you'd be able to furnish a cavern for free as your reward for this quest. Or you can choose to get a pig, or you can choose, if you're level 6 or lower, to get 2 coins, which coins are a currency throughout the game, but they're also victory points at the end of the game. You could choose to get an ore, or you could choose to get a pumpkin and anything below whatever level you're on. Now, if you go on a different type of quest, it might have a 2 on a circle, or a 3 on a circle, or even a 4 on a circle. And what that means is that you can choose up to 2, 3, or 4 of the rewards on this card, respectively, as long as you follow 2 rules. First of all, none of the rewards that you gain or earn can be higher than the level or strength of your current weapon for that character. Also, you can never get 2 of the same weapon. So you have a bunch of options to choose for, or 2 of the same reward, I should say. You have a bunch of options to choose from, and you could always choose one of them. And you could choose 4 different options for your reward if, let's say, you go on a level 4 quest. Now, the value of the strength of the weapon on the dwarf is actually very important, because as you're playing your worker placement actions, as you're making your turns or your decisions turn by turn, you can never place a higher ranked dwarf before a lower ranked dwarf. So that adds a wrinkle of complexity to the game, that once you start leveling up your characters, you have to start taking those actions in specific orders. So sometimes the first thing you might want to do with your turn is go on a quest, because you really want to snatch up that location before one of your opponents does. However, to go on a quest, you're going to need a character that has a weapon, unless you go to the forge a weapon spot. And if you do that, again, if your character has a weapon, then chances are they're higher ranked than some of the other dwarfs in your family. So you're going to have to take some of those actions first and wait till later on in the turn to execute the actions with your dwarfs that have weapons. Now, that's pretty much it as far as the components and the obvious comparisons in gameplay. Let's get back and hear my final thoughts and grades as far as these two games are concerned. So what are my final thoughts on Agricola versus Caverna? First of all, I like to say that I am a huge fan of both of these games. I find them both to be very highly enjoyable. And while they are very similar, obviously made by the same designer, and the same design philosophy was clearly in place when both of these games were made, while they're very similar, they are just different enough to warrant me keeping them in my personal collection. I know that a lot of people only want to keep or play one versus the other. I'm totally fine having both of them in my collection. And I do see them maybe more like spin-offs of one another than an actual expansion, right? Or second edition. Now, what do I think about them as far as different categories are concerned? First of all, let's start with components. As far as components are concerned, I'm going to give these games a tie. And while I did mention earlier in the video that the Caverna wooden pieces are a little bit thicker and chunkier, it's nothing drastic enough to make me choose Caverna over Agricola. It's the same idea, the same manufacturers, I imagine, that are making the components for both of these games. The same level of quality in the wood, in the cards, in the cardboard tiles. So again, I'm going to give it a tie. The artwork is from the same artists, the same painters, the same graphic designers. Everything is so similar that I'm not going to even justify trying to pick one over the other. So I'm going to give this a tie. Now let's move on to theme. For theme, I'm actually going to give the advantage to Caverna. While I do find Agricola to be very thematic, it does put me in that world of agriculture and farming. Not that in real life I'm big into farming, but I somehow like it for board games. It does transport me into that world. However, I do appreciate the twist that Caverna has to offer. In particular, the questing and exploration is a really neat twist. Also, just working on the dwarves' cavern, right? Expanding their cavern and expanding their living quarters. It's a very interesting thing. And again, I kind of immerse myself and put myself into that world. Now, I will admit both of these games, just like lots of Euro games, are not going to be as thematically immersive as your typical Ameritrash games, but I think that they get the job done considering the limitations, and I'm going to say that Caverna is slightly more thematically appealing to me than Agricola. Now let's talk about variety. Which game offers more setup variability? Which game has more long-term variability or replayability as the games go on? I'm going to give the advantage to Agricola, especially straight off the box. Straight out the box, Agricola comes with lots of minor improvement and occupation cards that you only play with a certain amount at a time per game. So you're always going to get the opportunity to have a different starting hand of cards from game to game, so that's going to make the games feel radically different. Lots of the other things as far as setup are concerned are going to feel very similar. Although there's 14 different round cards, there's a limit as to how much you can vary with those 14 round cards. You more or less know when the different actions are going to be introduced, and the same applies to Caverna. But in Caverna, your upgrades are done through those dwelling and furnishing tiles, and you pretty much have all of them available from the beginning of the game. Now, there is an easier versus a harder way of playing the game, which has fewer or more tiles available to you, but the point is that you basically have them in essence all available to you from the beginning of the game, and you can try and experiment different approaches and different strategies, although most people quite often don't. Once they find a recipe for success, they like to rinse, wash, and repeat over and over again. Agricola forces you to try different things because of those different hands of cards that you're going to have from game to game. Also, as far as expansion content is concerned, there's so much more out there for Agricola. We have the Farmers of the Moor expansion. We have all the different decks that have been produced that lots of them have gone out of print, but slowly Lookout Games is publishing them out year by year. Right now, we are about to have our fifth re-release of a Agricola deck of cards, an expansion of cards coming out with new minor improvements, new occupation cards for players to experiment with. So again, the variety is truly there. Now, Caverna has been catching up in recent years. They had the Forgotten Folk expansion that came out not too long ago, and I think it adds some variable player powers to the characters, which again will add lots to the variety. And they have a new expansion that's about to be released, I think, later on this year in 2021. So again, they are catching up as far as the variety is concerned, but right now I'm still going to give the edge to Agricola. Now let's talk about gameplay. And this is the most important grade, and I am going to give the edge to Agricola. And again, I think both of these games are really good, really fun. And I think it's more about the mood that I'm in, which will determine which game makes it to the table, more so than just a simple eeny, meeny, miny, moe approach. It's not that
simple. While they're very similar, they're different enough that the mood will determine which game I pick. But I think more often than not, I'm going to be in the mood for Agricola. Now, Caverna has lots of things going on for it, and it's really cool in that regard. It feels much more like a sandbox. It's much more open-ended as far as the choices you can make. And that's one of the limitations and the knocks that people have on Agricola. They feel like they're pigeonholed into particular strategies because they have to do a little bit of everything. And not only that, but every single category has a cap. It has a limit. It gets to a point where you cannot score additional points, so you might as well stop doing that one thing and focus on another thing. In Caverna, you can completely focus on one thing, and it could be very, very successful for you. Caverna has additional animals that are not included in Agricola. You have your donkey, you have your dog, which you cannot use for food. You cannot breed, but you know what? It gets you a few additional points at the end of the game, so you might want to get a few dogs there. Caverna also has additional resources. You have ore and you have gems, rubies that were not available in Agricola, and these resources are very valuable and very useful to you in the game. Caverna also has different actions that you can take, like mining and questing and excavating. These are very cool actions that are not available in Agricola, but are available in Caverna. And as I mentioned earlier, Caverna is the more generous game. The board itself comes with different spots that, once you cover them up, gives you a few resources as a reward. So it's an additional way of getting stuff. It's an additional way of getting food. The animals do not need to be cooked. You do not need any sort of cooking utensils or upgrades or major improvements in order to convert your animals into food, or your crops or your veggies into food. They can straight up at any point be converted into food. You have the ruby gem, which is kind of like a wild. It's a cool, easy way of getting another type of resource if you spend the right amount of ruby. And again, it just alleviates the pressure of trying to do particular things at particular times. The harvesting in Agricola or in Caverna is so much more softened. Yes, you still are expected to feed your people, but you have a good while. The first several rounds only have one harvest round. And once you do have those harvest rounds, some of those harvest rounds are very forgiving, because instead of having to feed your people two food apiece, you only have to feed them one food per family member. So again, all of these ways that Caverna takes the pressure off the players, allows them more to explore and to immerse themselves in that world. And again, with all that being said, you would think that I had said that Caverna was the winner as far as gameplay. But here's the thing. My sick, self-deprecating, masochistic tendencies actually make me prefer a game like Agricola. The stinginess of Agricola, the restrictions, the confines of Agricola actually appeal to me. I like the fact that I had to do a little bit of everything. I like the fact that the game itself keeps me honest. It keeps me on my toes. I like the fact that I had to consider everything that my opponents are doing, because I can't just be in my own world and try to outdo them through that. I need to be informed as to what they're doing, because some of their actions can interfere with mine. That's the thing about Caverna. I do feel that because it's such so much of a sandbox, it can be a little bit more multiplayer solitaire even than Agricola is, because who cares what this person is doing and how much points they're accruing? I am the king of pigs, and as long as they don't interfere with my breeding of my pigs, I'm fine. But no, in Agricola, you're always constantly on the lookout for all the different categories that you're trying to score on, and you're thinking about when your opponent might want to take a specific action before you do, but you really need to snatch that action up before they do. Really, really cool. I like the restrictions, the low scoring, and it also makes the minor improvement cards and the occupation cards so much more vital, so much more important, because Agricola can be a very low scoring game without the use of those cards. But if you can use those cards wisely and optimize your action through the use of those cards, you can build up a little bit more of a respectable score in Agricola. In Caverna, the scores are always going to be very, very high, very generous. And yes, you're probably going to walk out of Caverna feeling very accomplished and productive, even if you were were not the winner. But again, as far as I'm concerned, I prefer the tighter, more restricted approach of Agricola. And again, back to those minor improvement and occupation cards, I love the fact that we start the game by drafting these cards. In Caverna, you have your upgrades, you have your dwellings and your furnishings, and these are upgrades that you make throughout the game, right? Throughout the process of the game. And early on in the game, you might look at certain furnishings and dwellings, and based off past experiences and things like that, you might say, you know what, at some point, I'm going to be gunning for that one. But you don't know. In Agricola, you know you're starting upgrades. You know your improvements and your occupations. And it makes it the ultimate planning game because of that. Because before you even start the game proper, before round one even begins, you go through this card draft. And as you're making that card draft, you're basically in your head mapping out the way you want your game to turn out. You're mapping out the fact that, you know what, I want to find a way to optimize my sheep growing engine, right? Or I really want to grow my farm and my crops, or I really want to have an influx of food constantly coming in so I don't have to worry about feeding my family. So again, these cards and the drafting mechanism that happens before the game makes it the ultimate planning game. So again, it's all about knowing yourself as a gamer, your preferences, your tendencies. If you prefer the sandbox, open-ended experience, the more multiplayer solitaire experience where you're just doing your thing and everybody else around the table is doing their thing, then Caverna might be the way to go. But again, if you're like me and you prefer that tighter game experience, you prefer when the game puts the shackles on and limits you, and you've got to find ways to wiggle out and overcome those obstacles and overcome those circumstances in order to be successful. If you prefer that game approach or that approach into design, then Agricola will probably be the game for you. But both of these games are really, really good. Agricola also has the advantage on the price point. It is a cheaper game. So again, I'm going to say that overall, I'm going to give the grade or the benefit or the victory to Agricola. Agricola, out of these two games, is the better of the two. But Caverna is still a really, really good game. And that's it for today's board game comparison. Thank you so much for joining us here, folks. Comment down below and tell me which of these two games is your preferred game. Perhaps you don't like either one of these, but then I'd be very surprised as to why would you have wasted your time watching this video to begin with. Please comment down below. I'm interested in reading what you have to say. This is Harry saying take care, everybody. Stay safe, stay healthy, and have fun gaming.